Welcome to another SV Lynx video. Before we head over to the build site to show you the progress on our 50-foot performance cruising catamaran...
Whoa, hang on a sec. Why don't you explain why we call our Solitaire 1520 a performance cruising catamaran?
Okay, sure. The answer is simple. At her roots, SV Lynx will be a performance cat. She will be light, strong, with narrow hulls, shallow draft, have good bridge deck clearance, as well as daggerboards and kick-up rudders. She also has a generous sail plan, which we talked about in last week's video. Here's a link. All that makes her a fast-sailing performance catamaran.
Right, but tell everyone about how she'll be a world-cruising catamaran as well.
Well, besides all her performance features, SV Lynx also has a lot of comforts you get in a cruising-style catamaran design, like a large cockpit and salon, a protected helm, storage for sports equipment, even a bike garage. She won't be quite as fast as, say, a G-Force performance cat, nor have the living space included in a lagoon's wide hulls.
In other words, she sits in the sweet spot between a performance and comfortable world cruising cat with good speed and living space.
Yes. Since we plan to take her on a double circumnavigation of the entire planet, we want our cat to be a safe, comfortable home on the water, but she also needs to get us to each destination swiftly, partly because sailing a fast boat reduces the chance of us being caught out in bad weather. That's why we collaborated on the design to bring this new model into existence, so that we could have our cake and eat it too. Comfort and speed.
Okay, you mentioned a lot of things when you just talked about how she has performance catamaran features. One of the things you mentioned was kick-up rudders. Why do we need those types of rudders?
It's funny you should ask. That's why I have these parts of the boat sitting in front of us today.
I wondered why you had those out. Would you care to explain to our viewers?
Sure. These are the mechanisms that tie our kick-up rudders into the steering. Each of these lets their attached rudder shaft and casing kick up when needed. This longer arm ties into the steering, and the shorter one on top is where an emergency tiller can be attached if needed.
Aren't you getting way ahead of things? Maybe we should go over our rudder system for everyone.
Well, we did go over this in a previous video while answering a viewer's questions, but this time, let's go over the most common rudder systems on most catamarans.
Great. We can go into rudders a little deeper this time between showing everyone some of this week's build progress on SV Lynx.
All right. We can start with a build update from the beginning of this week. So we're getting ready to cut the front of the bow here. And so what we did is we printed out this from the plans and matched up the scale here to exactly the centimeter marks on here so that this is exactly to scale. And then we matched up the strong back at the bottom and the first of these bulkhead of the frame so this lines up, and then we leveled it here. And that gives us the part where we're going to cut the boat here. But that's not where the boat comes to. This is actually the front of the boat, but we build that out ourselves with fiberglass. So this is the part that the green foam is cut to here. And so then we marked this onto here. So this is the actual only line we need to cut right there. And then we're going to be building that out. So this all is going to go away. All right, so we've cut this off to the line now. This isn't the way it's going to be. We're going to still reform this here, but the front of the boat's going to extend much further out here. It's just that that's all going to be built up in a piece that we're going to create. So that gives us the inner portion of the curve, and then we'll extend this out. While Brian uses the multi-tool to get rid of some of the squeezed out epoxy inside the hull, I'm sanding the new edge we created along the top of the canoe, which will become the bottom of the hull after we flip the canoe over. Once the sanding was done, then what we did is we took some pieces of foam and inserted them between all of those strips and then clamped them down to make sure that that was ready to go for putting the epoxy on and making that permanently part of the boat. But once it looked good, we went ahead and put epoxy on and inserted that between those strips. Here it is going in, and it's fully epoxied. And once we get it in place, we'll use a whole bunch of clamps to make sure that it stays right where we want it. That will give us the surface that we need to put the front of the bow on, and then we can put our basalt around it. All right, so what we did is we put a piece of wedge-shaped foam inside of here. That way we could tighten this down and get the correct curvature that we want. And so we're going to let that set up. And then once this is all set up and holding it, then we'll create the rest of the nose piece that sticks out. But for today, that's about as far as we can go, because this is going to have to get very well cured before we can release these, because there's a lot of tension on these bringing this in. So it's going to have to cure for a while. So today we're back to working on the bow again. And we've got it trimmed off a little bit more and sanded down on both sides. And the insert that we put in yesterday is all set. So now what we're going to do is we're going to extend this out to the final point. And so we're going to glue a piece of foam on here that we're going to shape to get all of this working to the proper shape of the bow. So we're starting to work on some pieces over here. That's what Brian's cutting and pulling off the peel ply. We're going to have to glue those pieces of foam together so that we can have enough to taper it down to a point here, because this is about 2 inches wide and has to come to a very sharp point, which is going to be out about 5 inches from here. Now that you've seen some of this week's progress on the boat, let's get into catamaran rudders.
Okay, I'll start. Generally, most of the catamarans we considered buying used before we decided to build our own cat used fixed spade-style rudders. Those rudders are built around a metal shaft which comes up through the bottom of the hulls at the stern. Those shafts attach to the tiller arm of the steering system, typically joining the two rudders together by a rod.
Right. And those fixed rudders are usually paired with a catamaran that has fixed mini keels, like these.
Just a note, if you choose to beach this style of cat, we were told that it's a good idea to use blocks at the back of your mini keels so that you don't push down into the sometimes soft mud or sand bottom. That might cause your cat to tilt back onto those fixed rudders, and the weight of the boat could bend the rudder shafts. That would make for a very bad day.
When a catamaran that is engineered to be beached is resting on those mini keels, they keep the hulls high enough so that the fixed rudders don't reach the ground. But if you own a performance catamaran, like SV Lynx, it is highly likely that you will have dagger bores instead of mini keels. We went over this in detail in our video on our steering system, which you may watch at this link, or if you don't see it, I'll put it down in the description below. But we didn't talk about the difference between raising and kick-up rudders. Raising rudders lift straight up, allowing you to get them up and out of the way if you wish to beach your performance catamaran. Kick-up rudders are different in that they rotate upwards rather than lift straight up. But like raising style rudders, you can manually rotate them to an up position if you're about to beach the catamaran.
So you would want to have either raising rudders or kick-up rudders. But there's another advantage of both raising and kick-up rudders on a performance cat with dagger boards, and that's when you're caught out in a storm with high gusting winds. Common wisdom has you raise the leeward dagger board completely and run with the windward board about halfway deployed.
The idea is that if you were unlucky enough to be hit with a rogue massive gust of wind, like 80 knots, and it started to tilt your catamaran over, the windward hull will start to come out of the water, and if that happens, as the hull comes out of the water, it will lift that half-deployed windward dagger board out of the water.
But if the leeward rudder is down, it could also stop the cat from sliding.
Right, but with a raising or kick-up rudder, you may also raise the leeward rudder in these adverse conditions. Now, with both the leeward daggerboard and rudder raised, there's nothing left in the water to keep the cat from sliding during that rogue gust, and that could keep your boat from tipping over. Once the cat slides sideways across the water and the gust abates, the windward hull will drop back down, thus avoiding a capsize.
And, just to note, a shallow draft catamaran, like SV Lynx, is also helpful in this situation. Our Solitaire 1520 only drafts 1 foot 9 inches, or 54 centimeters.
Okay, let's get another progress report on the building of our cat. We did discover a bit of an issue with our device here. When you're running along the board, you could tilt this a little bit too easily, and that would make the edge of the blade catch the laminate a little bit. So we've gone with a Mark II. We've extended these arms way out so that now this can be held flat against the surface. That should work out a lot better, a lot more stable this direction. You have something to hold on to there to keep it from tilting. We'll give that a try. Here Brian is laying down on the job again. Well, actually what he's doing is using the Dremel to fix some of the turns where we couldn't get our router blade to reach in there. So we're doing our first rope into one of our bulkhead number 8. And we're supposed to get a 20 millimeter roll. So we did a little test piece and found that 29 inches gave us our 20 millimeter roll, just to mix your metric and your US stuff all in one sentence. But this is all experimental at this point for us, because this is the first rope we've made. So we don't know how it's gonna go, but we're gonna find out. This is rolling better than I thought it would. That's good news. Meaning, if we have to do this a lot, I don't want it to be difficult. Off we go. Oops. Okay. So now we insert into our trough, which is a problem because it's not fitting. I think it's too long.
Too big, too thick.
Yep, out we go. So we have a problem. Our rope's too thick, even though we pre-tested. The good news is we can cut it if we hurry. If we were too short, we'd be doomed. But since we're too long, we can cut some off. So let's just set it out here, and now we'll roll back. What do you think about that much? I need to get the scissors. The best laid plans when you pre-test. You think here? You think that much?
Huh? Yeah.
Okay. I'll go with it. Take two. Let's see if this works. Oh, I like this better. On this side, it was sticking up a lot. Okay, that works. Fun with sticky epoxy. And this is exciting and fun, isn't it?
Can I go sand?
Oh, Jesus, now he wants to sand. So maybe we should have used fast hardener. So it would set up faster when you could hold it in here until it goes. This is slow hardener. Takes longer. Of course, it's very warm right this minute of the afternoon, so it still should set up. Live and learn. So we've learned a few things here. We've got the length down now, so we know that we'll cut it a little bit shorter. And this is the right length. Gives us our 20 millimeters and 5 millimeters left over there, but we have trouble with it seeping back out again. So I guess we're just going to have to keep pushing it in until it sets up a little bit. But There's a lot of these to go, so that'll take some time. So today we are continuing to do our rope into bulkhead number 8. And we've got it dialed down now to a little bit better technique since the first one. We're getting the right amounts of epoxy, the right amounts of thickened epoxy to fill.
The right amount of help.
The right amount of help, because we've brought Ken in to help today. And when we're rolling these over 6 foot pieces, an extra pair of hands is quite nice. And we're rolling out unidirectional cloth to fill in those troughs that we cut. And our Mark II 3D printed routing jig making the troughs in there much faster and much nicer and much cleaner. And we didn't mess up any of the laminate as we got the foam out. So that works out swimmingly. And I got the epoxy on with the roller, but Ken and Brian are gonna squeegee it out with the metal rollers a bit to make sure that we don't have any excess in any places we don't want it. Another thing we learned to do is to put these up on blocks, because we got a little excess on the back side, as you'll see right over there on the very first one we did. And so we're adjusting that so that we don't have that. We can easily clean underneath, though we still have plastic down to catch any excess there.
We need our third roller guy.
Roller guy? Roller man. Oh, do we need t-shirts for roller guy?
I don't know how much rolling there is. I guess there's going to be a lot still.
There's going to be a lot of rolling. We're on bulkhead. Well, it's bulkhead number 8, but it's the first one we've done. Epoxy rope. A new skill to add to your list. Because we're such experts. This is.
You will be.
Yes, we will be. This is our fourth whole roll we've ever done.
Oh no, what's this?
All right, sausage.
Who's leading this train here?
Brian. Watch out for the camera.
It was very helpful having an extra set of hands with Ken there, so we could each take a 2 or 3 foot section and work the rope into it and get our 5 millimeter gap so that we can put our thickened epoxy on the outside. We need that because we need to be able to route a round edge on it later on. So, thanks Ken for showing up again.
All right, that's looking pretty good.
As you can see, the boat build is coming along nicely this week. Before we go back to the lot, let's talk about the difference between raising and kick-up rudders while sailing. When it comes to raising rudders, just like the fixed rudders, if you hit something heavy with them while underway, it will likely damage the rudder.
This is where kick-up rudders shine. They're made to release and rotate upwards if the rudder strikes something in the water, like a floating log or a reef. In that case, the rudder that hits the object will release and rotate upwards, allowing the object the rudder hit to pass by and not damage the rudder shaft and hopefully even the rudder.
And that's the reason we chose kick-up rudders for SV Lynx. But before we move on, I should mention that there is another somewhat odd advantage to having either raising or kick-up rudders. If you plan to sail around Europe, from the Med to Northern Europe or the UK, and we do, you will be sailing past Gibraltar, up the Portuguese coast, and onto Spain, then likely having to sail back down that coast later.
And if you've been watching the news, you probably know that this area is where the orcas have been attacking rudders on the sailboats. This has become a serious issue for sailboats. We've seen a recent report that claims between 1 and 3 sailboats are attacked daily. The orcas target the rudders, and once the rudders are shredded or torn off, they move on.
That's the odd advantage. With kick-up or raising rudders, you can get your rudders out of the water so that the orcas have nothing to damage. That way, in case of a sneak attack, which you don't see coming, you could just sail with one rudder down at a time.
That way, even if the orcas damage the deployed rudder in a sneak attack, once they depart, you'll still have your second raised rudder that you may now use to sail to a port to get repairs done on the damaged one.
So, we plan to have kick-up rudders on SV Lynx.
I think it's time to check back in at the build site.
Okay, but I have more to talk about on the rudders.
In a moment, just hang on to that thought.
We've been working on the nose, and as you can see, we have cut this nice piece here on our table saw, and that's going to fit right there, and we'll epoxy that right on, and it's a tiny bit large on purpose, just a little bit of an edge, so that we can do a little custom sanding on it and get it exactly as we like, but that's going to give us our point on the front of the boat, and all we have left to do is fix this little area right here, which will take some custom work, but as you can see, that's going to match up very nicely with the front of the boat.
Okay, now you can continue to talk about our choice for SV Lynx kick-up rudders.
Great. Let's talk about what it will take to create one of these kick-up rudder systems. First of all, we must consider rudder casings. These are basically a foam and fiberglass box that is shaped like a slice of the hull at the stern, as you can see in this concept model. The rudder shafts come up through each of these two rudder casings and attach to this rudder mechanism. As you can see, this allows the entire rudder and casing to pivot upwards if something strikes the rudder.
Of course, you also need a system in place to keep your kick-up rudders down while you're sailing.
We also went over the 3D printed release system we designed for SV Lynx in the steering system video we linked earlier.
This release mechanism is our own design and will be 3D printed by Engitype, one of our sponsors. That's the beauty of 3D printing. You can create a concept model on your computer, then immediately print it out and test it, all without the need of a machine shop. Then you can reprint iterations until you get to your final product.
If you're interested in learning more about 3D printing, I encourage you to join our patron crew. I used to work for Engitype, selling, maintaining, and using 3D printers of all kinds, so I know quite a bit about 3D printing. I am willing to try and answer any questions our patron crew might have, and if you want more information on purchasing a 3D printer, I can put you in contact with Engitype, or you can just stop by their webpage here.
Let's check in on the build site again and see where things are at.
So we've got our nose up of the bow, and we're just going to cut ourselves in a couple of biscuits. So we're taking out some bits here of the foam so we can get those in. That way we can glue this and have something to hold it while it's setting up.
We cut these biscuits out of some leftover cedar that we had from working on the forebeam. And before we seal this onto the front of the boat, we'll go ahead and completely cover them with epoxy so that the wood is sealed and won't have any problems with moisture. So now it's time to go off and do a little
quick test fit. Let's see, that would be the top. That would be the bottom, so they're marked. Okay, and now we gotta put the bottom and the bottom. Top with the top. Okay. Looking perfect.
Beautiful.
All righty. Ready to glue.
Epoxy's at top.
Don't worry about it for a second. I gotta do this stuff here. The bottom is to the left of me.
So then it was just a matter of mixing up our thickened epoxy, smearing it into the holes, and make sure we coat the entire wood dowel so that it's sealed up. Then we could place our new nose piece, after it was all slathered in epoxy, on, and then I held it steady, and Brian and Ken used tape to tape it back and pull it against the hull snugly. It's the only way we could figure out to hold it on there, and the tape held very well, so that worked out just fine.
Because I'm paranoid.
OK. Okay, before we stick this one down, let me step back where I can really look at this.
At this point, I was just making sure that it was absolutely lined up straight before we put the last pieces of tape on to hold it in place. Because once that epoxy sets up, that thing was never going to move again. So we had to be really sure it was in the right place.
I think that's as good as it's going to get. That's what I think. Looks the same on both sides to me. So we've got the nose on. Let's take a look at it. You can see. Decided that we just go some tape to hold it, right? And now everything looks fine with it. Like I say, we still have this whole top here that we have to work on and get that curve right. But the front of the boat is perfect. So that gives us that. And then, of course, we'll basalt this whole thing and it'll become very strong. We're at the end of Saturday and it's our last task. We had a bunch of goals today. This was the last goal of the day, so we've achieved everything today we wanted to do. The last goal is to join these two sections of bulkhead number 8 into one. So we have our little insert here that we're going to put in between. And we're going to epoxy this up right now. Get to it.
One thing we didn't show you is that we leveled both sides of the bulkhead with shims and made sure it was perfectly level before we seamed it together. And then, of course, we checked it again after we got it together.
All right, let's insert.
Just to make sure, because once this thing sets up, it needs to be a very flat surface to be our bulkhead.
Wunderbar.
You need a bang?
How?
No,
we're super straight. We are really good. It's sealed up and everything.
I love seeing the progress on our boat. Each day we get one day closer to sailing her around the world. But back to Kickup Rudders. Let's answer some of the concerns viewers have commented on after watching some of our videos. The main question they ask is, with a narrow slot for the casing, won't the Kickup Rudder hit on the sides of the opening if the rudders are turned and therefore catch on the sides of the hull bottom and fail to kick up and protect the rudder?
To answer that, let's take a look at two situations. The first is while sailing, and the second is while we are in low speed maneuvering using our propellers.
While sailing, you should seldom have your rudder turned all that much. If they're severely turned while you're sailing, then it's likely that your boat has weather helm.
That refers to a situation where your sail trim is way off, causing you to offset the tendency of the wind to try and turn the boat by using your rudders to keep your boat sailing straight. The way to fix this is not to use your rudders turned at a severe angle. That just causes drag and slows down your boat. Instead, you should adjust your sails. If the wind is turning your boat because of too much wind on the jib, you should trim or reduce the square footage of your jib, or trim and possibly shake out a reef on the main.
By adjusting the sail trim and area on either or both sails, you can balance out the force of the wind on your sails and get rid of that weather helm situation.
Now, when you're going about, on occasion, you may briefly turn the rudders hard over, but this is short-lived, and you will soon have your well-balanced boat back on track with the rudders straight.
Several other viewers have shown concern about low-speed maneuvering while using motors. Specifically, one mentioned the rudders hitting the coral bommies in a lagoon while turning the boat sharply.
Well, with the twin widely spaced props of a catamaran, you don't need your rudders to steer. Generally, they should be locked in the center position while you use the two throttles to control the thrust of the props to steer the boat. In the case where you're tooling around in a lagoon with lots of unknown bommies, the best bet for a boat with kick-up rudders is to just raise both rudders, since you don't need them anyway, with twin props for steering. That way, there are no rudders in the water to hit anything, and with the daggerboards up, we only draft 1 foot 9 inches.
But what about any disadvantages of kick-up rudders?
The most obvious one I can think of is complexity. A kick-up rudder requires a rudder casing and, more importantly, a mechanical mechanism. This is costly to make. Our mechanism costs $1,500 and time-consuming to build the casings. And being complex, you're more likely to have issues than a fixed rudder system.
and they can also get in the way if not specifically designed to be invisible, so to speak.
Now, when we ordered our steering mechanism from the manufacturer of our kit, we were led to believe that the tiller mount was removable. But on receiving this mechanism, you can see this is fixed and there's no way to take it off. But we'll fix that.
That's why on SV Lynx, we'll be changing the design of this rudder mechanism to get rid of the top tiller mount so that the entire mechanism is inset below the deck.
And that way, there will be nothing to trip over on the deck. This should have been designed that way to begin with, but we'll redesign it properly and have it modified. That way, when the tiller is not in use, we won't even know the mechanism is there.
The third issue is the mechanism that is used to keep the rudders down. As mentioned, we already solved that issue by creating small hidden compartments under the deck to hold the two 3D printed release mechanisms rather than going with what the manufacturer has suggested for previous boats.
So there are a couple of disadvantages. There are always pros and cons for everything, but we feel that these are small trade-offs compared to the advantages of these kick-up rudders. Besides, since SV Lynx will be a performance cruising cat with dagger boards, and we plan to beach SV Lynx at times, we must have either raising or kick-up rudders. Since both have nearly the same downsides, we figured we might as well get the upside of the kick-up rudders over just the raising rudders.
One of the things that does not come with the kit are the metal rudder shaft and other rods that are inside the rudders. We must have these metal parts created at a machine shop. Fortunately for us, we have a friend who owns a machine shop.
Michael DeRuder will build those parts of the rudders for us and modify this kick-up rudder mechanism to our new design before we build the casings from our laminate foam panels and fiberglass.
That wraps up our discussion about rudders and why we chose to go with kick-up rudder system for SV Lynx. We hope that answers any questions, but if not, just leave them in the comments and we'll answer.
And if you made it all the way to this point in the video, you're awesome! Thanks so much for watching. And thanks to all of our patrons of SV Lynx. By the way, we added the model for the 3D router jig to the download section of the patron crew portion of the website, in case you need it for your future boat build. And don't forget that we have another live Q&A session coming up on July 6th at 4 p.m. PST. And these are just for our patron crew. We look forward to chatting with all of you.
Finally, a special thanks this week to Dan Althaus and his company, Competition Electric, for sponsoring the build of SV Lynx by loaning us lots of the equipment we use at the lot, like ladders, racks for our rolls of fiberglass and carbon fiber, and some of our power tools.
It's great to have sponsors, and even better to have friends. Thanks, Dan.
Don't forget to like and subscribe, and click on the bell icon to be notified of our next video.
See you next week.